So welcome everyone. Today I'll be talking about what I really like to talk about, being a glaucoma and a cataract surgeon. Something that joins and combines glaucoma and the cataract surgery, about lens and angle closure like it has never done before. So I am from Hyderabad, and believe it or not, that photograph that you just saw is me not a long time back. So the objective of the presentation that I'll be doing today is to understand the role of lens in angle closure disease. Now you'll realize that I'm talking about angle closure disease and not angle closure glaucoma, because the angle closure disease includes a spectrum which includes primary angle closure suspect, primary angle closure, primary angle closure glaucoma, as well as acute primary angle closure, with a subvariant which may or may not be considered a complete part of it, the plateau iris. To understand the measurable parameters of the lens, to understand the impact of lens removal in angle closure disease, and the special consideration that one needs to give to plateau iris syndrome, and the consideration when you are doing a cataract surgery in one such patient, and how to decide between cataract and combined surgery. Well, there's no conflict of interest of financial implications of the presentation that I'm going to make today. So the lens. Now, I'll have a question for you about true relative pupillary block. What is true about relative pupillary block? The options are right in front of you. You can poll in and choose an option. The Mapstone's hypothesis explains the importance, its maximal mid-dilated position of pupil. The intraocular lens in sulcus is a factor, or IOP may rise in PACG by mechanisms other than relative pupillary block. Right, so most of you have actually got it right. You had to choose what is not correct here. So the intraocular lens in sulcus is a factor for secondary angle closure glaucoma by the mechanism pupillary block and by pigment dispersion, but not by causing a relative pupillary block. We'll go into what a relative pupillary block is. Now, what Mapstone told us almost 100 years ago and still holds true, not 150 years ago, the iris has two muscles, the sphincter pupillae and the dilator pupillae. The sphincter acts in the direction of the pupil, because the sphincter muscle is located around the pupil, whereas the dilator muscle is in the midstroma, so it acts in a direction that stretches from the pupillary margin to the root of the iris, and this keeps on changing. So you will see that at this point of time, the force of the sphincter is horizontal, and the dilator pupillae can be resolved into two vectors, one of which is pulling it down towards the lens and one of which is pulling it outwards. So when you put in dilating drop, a midriatic, it pulls the pupil rapidly outwards. However, at a point when the pupil is at a mid-dilated position, the configuration of the iris is such that in susceptible eyes, the sphincter pupillary force and the dilator pupillary force, they cancel out each other. The only force that's acting on the lens at this point of time is the force that is pulling the iris towards the mid circumference of the lens. And this is what precipitates a relative pupillary block and acute angle closure. Now, this was proven by Rich when he got a high definition UBM. And what you can see here is a mid-dilated pupil where the pupillary margin is adhered to the lens surface and what is called an iris bombé, causing an acute angle closure. So this proved that without the lens and the relative pupillary block happening, this iris bombé configuration and acute angle closure cannot happen. So this is pretty obvious and does not need any proof that pseudophakes cannot have a primary acute angle closure. It can be a secondary angle closure, but not a primary one. And you won't find evidence for it because it's very obvious and it's been noted throughout. And all these studies which have been done for cataract surgery and angle closure glaucoma mentioned that acute angle closure is not recurred again ever after PI, or maybe in case some cases after PI, but not after cataract surgery. So what are the parameters of the lens that we tend to measure with the anterior segment OCT? So there are a lot of things that the anterior segment can measure, but the primary thing of importance that the ASOCT measures, which cannot be measured by UBM or biometry, is the lens vault. Now, lens vault is the part of the lens or the height of the lens that lies above the line joining the two scleral spurs. So if you think logically, this is the amount of lens that is pushing the iris forward. So more is the lens for lens vault, more is the shallowing of the anterior chamber. And of course, there are a lot of angle parameters also, which tell us how shallow the angle is, like the angle opening distance, the angle recession area measured at angle recess area measured at 500 and 750 microns from the scleral spur, the trabecular iris surface area, again measured at 500 and 750. A lot of other parameters, but these are the main ones. So when eyes across the spectrum of angle closure were studied, people realized that the anterior chamber depth and other measures of anterior chamber depth rapidly decreased when one moves from the spectrum of primary angle closure suspect towards acute primary angle closure. And on the other hand, with the iris parameters remaining the same across the spectrum, what is causing it is the rapidly increasing lens vault from PACS towards acute primary angle closure. Now, this was the population that was different from this study. And this study also shows the same results, rapidly declining angle depth parameters, increasing lens thickness, and lens vault. The lens vault is much more responsible for decrease in anterior chamber depth than the lens thickness. So even if the lens thickness is not increasing that much, the lens vault is increasing because of possibly an anteriorly positioned lens. So that is what causes an increase in lens vault. So you see here that the fellow eye of the acute angle closure, primary acute angle closure eyes, they have much higher lens vault than the other lower ranks of angle closure disease, including chronic angle closure glaucoma, which means that these are more susceptible to having an attack of acute angle closure. And quite logically, what happens is when you do a surgery in these eyes, these parameters change drastically. So these parameters change drastically because the lens vault is removed. And this will change most drastically in acute angle closure and least drastically in primary angle closure suspect. So it's quite well known now that the lens parameters, the thickness, and especially the vault go on increasing from normal to PACS to PACE to PACG to acute primary angle closure eyes. Now, as we discussed, the cataract surgery will deepen the anterior chamber. But what more will it do? This is another question for the audience. FICO emulsification will reduce the intraocular pressure maximally in which condition? Acute primary angle closure, primary open angle glaucoma, pseudo exfoliation, or pigmentary glaucoma? Various studies have shown reduction in intraocular pressure. Around 30% of you are not absolutely correct because you have chosen options other than acute primary angle closure, that which is the correct answer. Now, what you are seeing here is a forest plot. The forest plot on the top shows you the amount of intraocular pressure reduction from baseline, which is the central line, in various studies. The larger is the box, the larger is the sample size, and the farther away it is from the center, the more is the reduction. So you see, when I place two similar red color boxes on both these lines, you see there is a much more number of studies showing greater decrease in eyes with primary angle closure glaucoma. So it's very clear that though there is a reduction in open angle glaucoma, which here also includes pigmentary and pseudoexfoliation glaucoma, the decrease is far much more in angle closure disease. And all these studies just pull the data in favor of angle closure glaucoma. I'll come to more of it. Before that, there's another question for you. A patient with acute angle closure has been on maximal therapy for 3 days. The intraocular pressure is still 58. There is dense corneal edema. The evidence-based recommendation says that the best next step is... Right, it's very interesting. It's interesting because in different conditions, all of these hold true. So pilocarpine is not an option because maximal medical therapy means that patient is already on pilocarpine, and going intracameral with an eye with pressure of 58 would be very dangerous. Argon laser won't penetrate a streamy cornea that well, or at least won't be able to do an iridotomy that well. What is recommended in this situation is either the laser iridoplasty or a surgical PI. This was the classic recommendation till cataract extraction came in. Now let's look at the evidence to find the answer. There are various prospective non-comparative trials with small sample size, which show that in acute angle closure, the success of intraocular pressure reduction is 100% with very few complications. So this should mean that if there is a patient with acute primary angle closure, instead of doing a PI or a peripheral iridotomy, you should go and do a cataract surgery. But it doesn't completely hold true because the second half of the table will show you that these are patients who in most of these situations had mild to moderate severity of angle closure disease. And none of these definitely had an intraocular pressure of 58. The visual acuity in these patients also don't seem to be very great. After doing a cataract surgery, you don't expect 40% of your patients to have the best corrected visual acuity to be less than 20/40, and even worse in some of the series. Now, isolated case series are not the best examples, so you should look at randomized control trials. So let's see if they're randomized control trials good enough for this. These are the two biggest randomized control trials which have compared a laser PI to FICO emulsification, and they show good results. What they do show is that the intraocular pressure outcome is much better with FICO emulsification with greater absolute success, lower intraocular pressure, and lesser number of failures. The complications are also not much, but one of the things that is very common is some febrile. But what you should look at here is that the visual acuity again is not very great. And in one situation, the laser PI group randomized to laser PI actually has better visual acuity. So the most important thing is not this, but what is the most important thing is in these patients, in the randomized control trials, these were very well controlled acute primary angle closure situations where the intraocular pressure was either less than 30 or less than 21 after medications. So though there is evidence to suggest that in mild to moderate acute primary angle closure, cataract surgery works very well, there is no evidence to suggest that it will do equally well in patient who has an intraocular pressure of 58, despite maximal medical therapy for 3 days. And doing a cataract surgery there might be very risky. And the definite answer to the question of what the evidence-based recommendation is clearly that you don't have evidence for doing a cataract surgery or a lens extraction in such a situation. Now, this table just goes on to show that not only FICO emulsification, but even ECC had very good result across decades in all the series. And there is significant variation here. So the success percentage is not uniform. It is as low as 5% in certain situations, 65% to 76%. So what one has to realize is that the success is not uniform throughout the spectrum. And there is quite a bit of variation here. So when we look at the most successful studies, we tend to get carried away. But one has to remember that not all studies in even acute angle closure show an excellent result. Sometimes there may be as many as 30% patients who didn't have a good reduction of intraocular pressure despite maximal medications. Now, what you have here is that apart from intraocular pressure reduction, the cataract surgery in patients with primary angle closure glaucoma, not the acute situation, also reduces the amount of fluctuation. Now, this is quite surprising, but probably the cataract surgery is doing more than just reducing the anterior chamber depth. And this then happens to be a result of that action. So to summarize, we know that cataract extraction will reduce the intraocular pressure and its fluctuation, and that it is increases in proportion to the increase in depth after surgery. The reduction is hence maximum in acute primary angle closure, but you cannot extrapolate the results to severe uncontrolled acute primary angle closure. There is one special situation, the plateau iris, which is quite common in the Asian and the Southeast Asian population. One must also remember that the angle closure glaucoma in the Caucasian population is not very common. And a lot of people believe that most of the angle closure in the Caucasian population happens as a result of plateau iris. So this is not a situation which is isolated to the Asian or Southeast Asian population, but is universal. And more studies are showing African and African continent population from African continent and Caucasian groups to have plateau iris. So what happens when you do a cataract surgery in plateau iris? What Rich and his team showed that the angle here failed to open despite an increase in the anterior chamber depth. So the anterior chamber depth in those days, which was measured centrally and probably the ASOCD was not this developed, has increased, but the angle remains closed in all these patients. On the other hand, you have evidence that the filtration has become better after a cataract surgery by the virtue of reduction of intraocular pressure and the prone position test being negative. So the same authors have also shown images where they have shown that the anterior chamber, peripheral anterior chamber depth or the angle has opened up after cataract surgery compared to the preoperative images. What they have also noted is the ciliary processes, which are aligned a little forwardly oriented, have the direction of the ciliary processes have also changed. So there is contrary evidence, though these studies are from two different populations. So are we looking at two different kinds of plateau iris, or are these two different spectrums of plateau iris? You don't know, but this study which showed the angle to have opened has been done in the Southeast Asian population, a Japanese population to be more exact. And the study which showed that the angle did not open up was in a Caucasian population. So what is unknown is the impact that cataract surgery is going to have on eyes with plateau iris. Now, once we know that the cataract surgery is beneficial, at least in a lot of situations, why is it a challenge to do a cataract surgery in angle closure glaucoma? First of all, it's a shallow anterior chamber, quite clearly. And you not only struggle because you have very little space to emulsify the nucleus, but also because the fluidics of most modern day FICO machines would get altered when the amount of vertical space for the fluid to move becomes limited. The lens is quite large, and which means that you need to emulsify a lot more of the volume and need to use a lot more energy. The pupil tends to be small in these cases, either because of iris atrophy or use of pilocarpine. The patients are very frequently on pro-inflammatory prostaglandin analogs and pilocarpine, which happens to be the drug of choice for plateau iris syndrome. And there is a problem with intraocular lens calculation also. We'll look at that. And you cannot predict for sure, or you at least need to monitor the intraocular pressure control prior to and after the surgery. Now, why the cataract surgery option is enticing is because it has got fewer long-term complications, but short-term complications are not completely get rid of the short-term complications, and sometimes have complications like intraop shallowing, corneal edema, decompensation, aqueous misdirection. So what kind of preoperative preparation is required for these patients? Let's just go through one more question here. So what is true about, the cataract surgery being performed in a patient during FICO emulsification, whether you should always do a surgical PI, you should give acetazolamide, corneal decompensation is more common, or you should discontinue pilocarpine and PG analogs right on the day of surgery. I hope I get some wrong answers, because that will mean that I have some opportunity to share some new information. Okay, I can see the answers right now here. And the second least chosen option is post-operative acetazolamide reduces the chances of IOP spike. Now that happens to be the true option here, true answer here, because a percentage of patients who get spike after cataract surgery without acetazolamide ranges from 30 to 70%, and with acetazolamide maybe as low as 5%. So especially if the patient was on anti-glaucoma drugs, do give oral acetazolamide to patients if there is no contraindication during the immediate post-op period. Also, the pilocarpine, which not only increases the pupil constriction, but also increases the chances of inflammation when you handle the iris during surgery, should be stopped 1 to 2 weeks in advance and should be replaced with acetazolamide if there is no contraindication again. Prostaglandin analogs can continue till the day of surgery and stopped for about 8 to 12 weeks. Now, there is a lot of evidence and voices rising in favor of resuming PG analogs early, but not enough evidence now. And please do remember to control and monitor the intraocular pressure preoperatively and reduce it to as much as possible through medications. And in certain situations, an intravenous mannitol injection may be required. Now, as I said, intraocular lens calculation is a challenge. So which of the formula here is accurate enough to have a prediction capacity of 95% for a residual refractive error of less than 0.25 diopters? Not an uncommon demand in today's world, especially if you want to do a clear lens extraction. Okay, SRKT. Now, what I'll share now is information from various studies which show that in this study, around 40 eyes, 40 to 45 eyes from two groups were compared. And with obviously the anterior chamber being shallower, the lens thickness being smaller, But what is important to note here is that the axial length is still quite normal. So 22.62 plus minus 0.86 is not small eyes. It's very much within the normal range. But what surprise you get here is that 21 eyes or 50% of eyes end up with a spherical equivalent greater than 0.5. So the formulae are not even 50% accurate. And none of these parameters, the lens thickness or the AC depth, anterior chamber depth or the axial length, actually can predict the problems here. Now, another study which looks at various formulae found that the Haggis formula was most accurate. The Hoffer Q and SRKT actually not doing too well with quite a high number or amount of variation in the ultimate refractive error, myopic in Hoffer Q and hyperopic in SRKT. In the same study, the percentage of subjects which were off by more than 0.5 was 50% for Haggis, 44% for SRKT, and 31% for Hoffer Q. None of these are actually acceptable. So one can easily say that these are studies which are at least 7-8 years old. So I'll come to a trial, the Eagle trial, which is one of the most talked about trials as far as clear lens extraction in angle closure goes. This also showed that almost 40% of patients were off by more than 0.5 diopters and 15% by more than 1 diopter in angle closure glaucoma. So this is something that I discovered not very early in my understanding of angle closure, but because of factors which are unknown or not yet revealed by studies, the formulae don't work well. And you may end up slightly hyperopic in these patients. So if you are using any of these formulae, please aim for a slightly myopic refraction. What is a much better bet is to use modern formulae like the Barrett's, which is available freely online, and ask for parameters which all the machines measure, and you can actually do it. So though there are no studies looking at angle closure, Barrett's in a large scale series of more than 10,000 eyes was proven to be the most accurate formula. So let's hope Barrett does the trick. You should also avoid multifocals in these patients, especially in presence of a PI or in a patient who has a significant glaucoma, because the contrast sensitivity is already hit and you don't want to reduce the contrast further than what it has already become. Also, if you want to do a toric IOL, you must inform the patient that in case a trabeculectomy is needed in the future, the toric intraocular lens may not work as well as it is working right now. Preoperative intravitreous mannitol is something that we use for all advanced glaucoma and patients with plateau iris syndrome. What is important to remember is you should use it at least an hour in advance, because though the medication, the mannitol, starts acting by 30 minutes, the peak of action is not reached by 1 to 1.5 hours. So you should wait for some time after the mannitol injection to start the surgery. You cannot just expect the mannitol to work after you have given it 5 minutes back. What is a surprise benefit of giving mannitol is that you'll see here that it also deepens the anterior chamber. So it has deepened it from 2.84 mean millimeter value to 3.30. So you will not only get a eye with pressure that is not high, you will also get a deeper anterior chamber, which reduces your challenges during the surgery. And this brings us to the next question. Which one of these is wrong? Okay, so the maximum number of people feel that you should not use a rapidly acting mydriatic, and 40% have chosen the right option, that intraoperative pilocarpine will reduce the chances of floppy iris. This is a wrong statement. Now, the logic behind using a rapidly mediatic combination along with a long-acting one is because you don't want the pupil to get stuck in the mid-dilated position. So you want it to move rapidly and with strength so that it can overcome the power of the sphincter pupillae and not let the pupil get stuck in a mid-dilated position. And if that happens, that is when the intraocular pressure starts rising. The chances of a upward positive pressure and vitreous loss and aqueous misdirection go up. The other things I will discuss. So dilatation is should be started 15 to 20 minutes because the rise of intraocular pressure starts happening about 40 to 50 minutes after instillation of a mediatic, when the action of the mediatics become a little slower. So if you use a mediatic like tropicamide, the action starts declining 45 minutes onwards. And it's been noted that the pupillary block happens about an hour and a half later, the painful pupillary block. So it's probably set up around 40, 45 minutes. So you should not be doing a surgery at that point of time. And as I said, you should use a rapidly acting and a combination of strong mediatic. Why do you want to use cycloplegia along with mediatic? Is because it will help in deepening the anterior chamber by shifting the iris lens diaphragm backward. And this is important, especially in plateau iris, which is a risk factor for aqueous misdirection. And it is also protective against floppy iris. So it is not constriction which reduces floppy iris, but dilatation. And the iris in patients with angle closure, especially those who have had a PI, tend to be very floppy. And once you have the iris coming to the wound, the side port or the FICO incision, it just begins a chain of unfortunate events. You should not allow this to happen. The other thing is, it is best to do these surgeries under topical anesthesia. But if you want to use anesthesia because of the challenging surgery, you should use the minimum amount of block, minimum volume of block for a peribulbar anesthesia, because the parameters here clearly show that the blood flow through the optic nerve head decreases after a retrobulbar anesthesia. And in an eye which is compromised because of primary angle closure glaucoma, it may react very badly and have a wipeout if you reduce the blood flow further. At least it increases the chances of wipeout if you really push the huge volume into the orbit. Also, avoid compression or ocular massage with pinky ball. And it is shown that in patients who have had peribulbar with compression, these are the patients where the intraocular, the optic nerve head blood flow becomes the minimum, though the others are not spared. So the best way to go ahead is a topical or subconjunctival anesthesia. But if you want to give anesthesia, you should use either a posterior subtenon or subconjunctival. If you have to give a peribulbar, avoid retrobulbar, which has greater chances of compressing the optic nerve and reducing the ocular blood flow. Give small amounts of injection inferotemporally and wait for the eye to become soft and then repeat if required. But don't use any compression on the eye to make it either soft or to spread the anesthetic. It is also important to avoid a large volume of intraorbital local anesthetic because it's a risk factor for positive pressure. In our practice, we use a lightweight titanium self-retaining speculum and make sure that it is not really stretching the eyelid, because once you start stretching it, the pressure goes and gets transmitted to the globe. And in a susceptible case, this may start a chain of increased positive pressure and then go further onwards. Now, what is very often neglected, that straining also causes similar problems. So please ask your patient if they want to go to the restroom prior to the surgery, especially if you have given mannitol, because that's a very strong diuretic and you don't want your patient to desanitize your operation theater, and you definitely don't want to be in a situation where the bag is touching the endothelium. Clear corneal FICO is the best option, but if one does a manual small incision cataract surgery, please leave one quadrant of conjunctiva untouched if you need to do a trabeculectomy later on. You cannot use all the cones yourself as a cataract surgeon. Please, for a glaucoma surgeon, please leave some conjunctiva for me. A clear corneal ECC in hands of a trained surgeon may work better than a manual SICS, because that is conjunctival sparing. But if the case is challenging, use the technique that you are most comfortable with. I will share a small video which encapsulates the challenges and the principles of surgery. And this is the patient who had an acute angle closure. The lens has a very early cataract, and I'm doing a cataract surgery here. So what may be clear is that this is a topical anesthesia, and while going in with the MVR for the paracentesis, I'm trying to be as parallel to the iris as possible, and also making it slightly longer than other patients. If you see here, you can see the site of the peripheral iridotomy, and though this is my natural site to do a paracentesis, I am going a little away because the iris around this place is likely to be very floppy. Now, after you have done the paracentesis, you can dilate the pupil using either a viscoelastic. So what you see here is that I have gone and hit the iris. There is no space in the anterior chamber. And that is why what I did was started injecting viscoelastic right from here, so that the iris goes down and then the anterior chamber can get filled up. So then the anterior chamber gets filled up from the top of the cornea and not from the bottom, because that is likely to push the iris outwards. And be careful not to overfill the anterior chamber here, because that again can push the iris back into the paracentesis. The rexis tends to be slightly tricky because these are large lenses, and the rexis repeatedly needs to be pulled. I don't know if you were disturbed or not, but I definitely got disturbed by your call. So you need to be careful that the rexis does not run out, and try to manage the rexis with not a huge volume of viscoelastic. The FACO incision again should be slightly longer here. I'm struggling with the keratome, not a pleasant sight. When you do the hydro, don't overfill the eye. So because if the lens starts coming up, it can become nasty. Now, typically you are told to keep the irrigation on while going in, but because here a sudden increase in intraocular pressure can again prolapse the iris, I went in with irrigation switched off and then switch on the irrigation gradually. You can change the settings on your FICO machine to do that. And if you see, the irrigation port is again not directed towards the pupil, because I don't want to disturb the pupil. I don't usually do a stop and chop, but here the advantage of doing a stop and chop is you will get a lot of volume centrally to do the FACO emulsification, and the fluidics will improve when you have the vertical space to move for the fluid to move. Now, because the fluidics here won't work well because of a crowded chamber, you may actually use the second instrument to pull the quadrants close to your FICO tip before you actually do the FICO emulsification. Be careful to do the FICO emulsification away from the endothelium, because the natural tendency for you to be, for one, is to come closer to the endothelium, because then you'll get more space. But chop into multiple small pieces and do a FICO behind or at the max in the pupillary plane. Now, once you have taken a few quadrant pieces of the nucleus out, not a full quadrant, you will start getting more space, and then you can later on do the FICO with a larger piece of the nucleus again. Now, I don't know why I have so much of FICO shown here in the video. The IA is typical. Be sure not to shallow the anterior chamber too much. The intraocular lens that you place, this one is a hydrophilic intraocular lens. The haptic should be placed in 3 to 9 o'clock direction. You can move it with the bimanual or a Sinsky. Here I have using a bimanual to do that. And the superior and inferior, this 12 o'clock position is spared because you might need to do a trabeculectomy later, and you don't want the haptic of the IL to prolapse through that iridectomy. Now you see, despite all precautions, at the end of the surgery, I'm getting iris into the wound, into the paracentesis here. So what must be done is you start inflating from one end, but don't inflate it too much. Go in very small steps. And once the iris falls back, make sure there is no leak, and then close the eye. At the end of the surgery, for a pressure, you always check the pressure over the cornea with a metallic instrument, and don't leave the eye overfilled. So this is what a typical surgery with angle closure glaucoma is. A lot of cases are much more difficult. We have many patients of plateau iris who have a very small pupil. Principles of management of small pupil come into force, but largely the principles remain the same. So what about the post-operative management? Typically, you give a steroid and antibiotic, but don't forget to give oral acetazolamide if it's not contraindicated. And drugs which are contraindicated, like pilocarpine and PG analogs, should be replaced with alternative agents, and if required, with oral agents. And it is beneficial to use NSAID drops for 6 to 8 weeks, especially if a prostaglandin analog has been used preoperatively. If you get a spike, use acetazolamide always with a potassium supplement. Before making a decision of going ahead with a surgery, control the inflammation as well as you can, because it is largely the inflammatory cells and pigments which are dispersed during surgery that very often cause the trabecular meshwork to function suboptimally. Use syrup glycerol if you have to delay the surgery. It's best to do the surgery maybe 4 to 6 months later. Not instantly, but don't run away from it if you have to do it. You can resume the PG analogs after 3 months. Do not forget, very silly thing to write here, but I have seen cataract surgeon doing it. Do not forget to give a prescription of the anti-glaucoma medication rather than just telling the patient to continue the drugs, because not everyone is as intelligent as the surgeon. And do not forget, for the management of glaucoma, you need to repeat the fields after 2 to 3 months for a fresh baseline with a clear media. One of the biggest questions that comes to us is, when do you decide to do a combined rather than a cataract? Now, a cataract is preferable because the combined surgeries is associated with a lot of long-term complications and requiring a lifelong follow-up. But what is very clear is that in patients who have had combined surgery, the intraocular pressure tends to be lower than that with FICO emulsification, provided both are done well. So you might want to do combined for this benefit of 2 to 3 millimeters of mercury in certain situations. Now, what are those situations? So if a patient has advanced glaucoma, he is on two or more medications, remember that the only medications that you will be able to use in the immediate post-op period are the only topical medications are a beta blocker, an alpha agonist, and a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. The anticholinergics and prostaglandin analogs are ruled out. So if you have a patient on two or more medications and with advanced glaucoma, you think cannot tolerate spikes, better do a combined. The incidence of spikes with combined are likely to be much less than that with cataract. A patient with moderate glaucoma on three or more medications, a patient whose glaucoma has been progressing despite the good control, a patient who cannot afford the economic burdens of using multiple medications or whatever the current medication the patient is on, a patient who has difficulty in following up, combined after the initial follow-up, if the patient does well for the initial few months, is likely to do well for a very long time, and if the lens factor is insignificant as measured by the lens vault. A lens vault that is less than 700 microns or so, though there is no definite cutoff for me, that is the cutoff, is not very significant. So a lot of this stuff here was eminence-based rather than evidence-based as far as the recommendations for between combined and cataract is concerned. But this is what we practice and we at LV Prasad and largely across India would agree upon. So to summarize what I spoke till now, very clearly, the lens is an essential component of relative pupillary block. And a patient who does not have angle closure glaucoma will not go on to develop angle closure glaucoma if the lens is removed. A patient will not develop acute angle closure. And cataract extraction will cause a benefit in patients across the spectrum of primary angle closure disease, though most in acute primary angle closure. Not all patients are benefited equally, and unfortunately, we don't know what factors will absolutely for sure predict the outcome as far as the intraocular pressure is concerned. In patients with acute angle closure who are under good control or borderline control, FICO emulsification is a good option. I would like to do a PEI and then go ahead with the cataract surgery because the In our opinion here, the chances of developing an aqueous misdirection is lesser with a patent PI. And don't treat this as a completely normal FICO emulsification. Take care preoperatively, intraoperatively, and in the postoperative management. So a lot of things that we know, but there are a lot of things which are still unknown, which are the dynamic properties of the lens. Just like the iris, the lens also moves. So does that have a play role to play? What are the causes of persistent occludability? And how do you ascertain whether it's just a pupillary plateau iris or the lens thickness that is causing it? And what kind of factors can predict the intraocular pressure outcomes and chances of complications in a patient with angle closure glaucoma? And surprisingly, even in today's age, we are not sure of the IL calculation that are available, but there is promise in form of new formulae. One has to remember that lens is not the only factor, and there are factors beyond pupillary block. So a patient with gross trabecular meshwork damage and goniosyneche is likely to benefit a little lesser. A patient in whom choroidal expansion or plateau iris is a prominent factor, they may not benefit as much as the other patients without these factors. So keeping in mind these factors, if one is careful and looks carefully at the data in front of their eyes, you can actually benefit the patient a lot with your cataract surgery, which is done carefully. So that's all from me. And I'll be happy to take questions from the audience. So the first question is, which is better, combined or a single surgery. So as I said, if the patient has advanced glaucoma, you need to be very sure that there should be no spike. One, when you need to be very sure the patient does not need more than two medications, like in advanced glaucoma, the patient is on two or three medications, there you would prefer a FICO trap. But on most situations, in good hands, you would prefer to do a cataract alone rather than a combined surgery. Iridectomy during surgery is not necessary because you are eliminating a pupillary block, relative pupillary block, by taking out the lens. However, if you see an increased risk of aqueous misdirection, like in cases of severe plateau iris, a prior PI, laser PI, or a surgical PI is not going to cause you any harm. What is your opinion about the use of anterior chamber maintainer in these type of cases? Excellent question. And anterior chamber maintainer, even in the presence, even when you're doing a FICO emulsification, you would prefer to do if and only if you foresee a significant risk on shallowing of the anterior chamber suddenly. So this kind of risk is greatest in patients who have had an aqueous misdirection earlier in the same eye or in the other eye, and in patients with severe plateau iris where you can see a sine wave sign clearly on gonioscopy, or UBM reveals a grossly forward anteriorly directed ciliary process. Other than that, we don't use a anterior chamber maintainer. So Ollie is asking, I once performed an argon laser iridoplasty in an LPI with phacomorphic glaucoma. What do you want to do in such a case? Look, you have to really be sure that the eye has no visual potential. Now, by the virtue of having a pressure of 50 millimeters of mercury, an eye with otherwise 2200 vision may become no perception of light for a temporary time. But the more common cause that falsely gives you no perception of light is not using a bright enough source of light. So if you are not 100% sure that you've taken care of this, please take care of this. But if you're sure that the eye has no perception of light, surgery would be indicated if the patient is in severe pain because of the raised intraocular pressure and you cannot control the pressure otherwise. But transscleral cyclophotocoagulation is also an option to reduce the pain. Because in a patient which has long-term and severe phacomorphic glaucoma is also a risk factor for aqueous misdirection. So tread carefully, but there may be situations where you would still want to do a cataract surgery and take out the lens which is causing the problem there. Any role of topical glycerin to decrease corneal edema to improve? Yes, I have not personally used it, but I have seen videos. I know of people who use it. If it's available as a sterile solution, you can definitely use it. Otherwise, in situations where you desperately need a view, scraping off the epithelium is an option because the edema, because of raised pressure, lies within the epithelium, the microcystic edema. Okay. The next question is, an angle closure patient, should you use adrenaline? Yeah, I like to use adrenaline. If there is no cardiac disease, be careful not to excessively use adrenaline in patients with cardiac diseases because it can cause tachycardia and challenges the heart to pump more. So not only intracameral adrenaline dilates the pupil, but it will also act as a prevention factor against floppy iris. Along with intracameral adrenaline, you can also use an intracameral preparation of lignocaine, because the mechanism of action for dilatation through lignocaine is different from adrenaline. It acts as an adjuvant to adrenaline. I have found that the adrenaline, which is mixed in the irrigating solution of about 500 ml in a volume as low as 1 ml of 1 in 10,000 also works well. So you don't really need to inject adrenaline separately. Just the irrigating fluid that you have in a syringe for hydro procedures will serve equally well. No harm in using intracameral adrenaline though. Oh yeah, pupil expanders are a must. Now, this is a very interesting question because the view that we share here is that in eyes with angle closure glaucoma, most of the intraocular pressure rise happens because of pigment dispersion. So manipulating the pupil, touching the pupil is something that you won't really want to do. If you can do it without the pupil expanders, which will cause pigment dispersion, do it. But if you think the safety of the surgery is compromised, please don't hesitate in using a pupil expander. Also, an iris hook rather than a circular pupil expander or a pupillary ring like a Malayugan ring or a B-hex ring that is available in India would be preferable, but because that is an additional protection against the floppy iris. So an iris hook over a ring if you have to use it. Okay. Now, you are doing peripheral iridotomy in patients with PACS, okay. Now, usually, we don't do anything for patients with PACS apart from observation. There is lack of good quality data, but the present understanding is that over a period of 5 years, maybe only 10 to 15% of patients will progress to PAC and none of them to PACG. So if over a five-year period, none of these patients are going to have any visual field loss or optic nerve damage, why do you want to treat these patients by doing anything? I would guard against doing a clear lens extraction for any of these patients because as you saw, the visual acuity outcome in many of these studies is not optimal. So if a patient who is 20/20 with maybe even hyperopic glasses like me, you cannot be 100% sure that you will get the patient a 20/20 vision after doing a clear lens extraction. So the risk in my opinion is high. I wouldn't recommend that. Site of PI, the recent studies of a large number of patients from India, Arvind Madurai, has shown that the site of PI does not differ, does not make any difference as far as visual symptoms are concerned. However, again, there is another caveat here, is that the angles tend to open maximally near the site of the PI, though there is not much difference. So you can choose to do it slightly superiorly because in most of the primary angle closure disease, the superior angle is shallower than the inferior angles. But in a patient who has thick iris and a crypt at 6 o'clock, please don't hesitate in doing it anywhere. There is hardly anything that any way you can harm the patient. And I do it anywhere. None of my patients actually complain of any symptoms. I have had patients who have a well-covered peripheral iridotomy done superiorly and have symptoms. And even the randomized controlled trial did not show any difference in visual symptoms. So visual symptoms point of view, nothing to care about the sight. The superior angle closes first in primary angle closure disease across all the spectrum. However, there is a variety of angle closure that is called creeping angle closure, where the angle closes gradually in all sides. So if you see an angle that is partially closed all around, then you can diagnose creeping angle closure and it is a progressive disease. There you need to do PI. Otherwise, it will progress further. the role of vitreous tap is controversial, but can have a role in patients with proven risk of malignant glaucoma and nanophthalmos. But be very careful while doing it. You cannot be doing it with a syringe and a needle. You need to do it with a very well-controlled automated vitrector. I have come across many cases and witnessed one case which had a suprachoroidal while doing a dry vitrectomy. So this is not risk-free. If we can do without it, please do without it. If you want to really do it, be sure that an expert is handling a very good quality anterior vitrector, which is not a probe that is meant for anterior vitrectomy, but that is one that is meant for past plena vitrectomy. Thank you, CyberSight.
Thank you,
Lawrence.
Have a good day. Bye-bye.
Good day to you too. Bye. Good day, everyone.